Daniel for your kind introduction, and to the organizers of the conference for inviting me to speak. Inerrancy of Scripture, Evangelical and Catholic Perspectives. I don't know what you thought when you first heard or read this title. What could the white fundamentalist Americans who voted Trump to power contribute to a new and strong Catholic understanding of the difficult topic of the inerrancy of Scripture? Is that what you heard when you read the title for the first time? If it is, I want to commend you for still being here. Instead of skipping my lecture and enjoying a good coffee and Leuven. Of course, I understand that you may feel trapped and cannot leave without leaving behind your good manners. I hope, however, that your patience will be rewarded. So, for ecumenical purposes, bear with me a little longer. Just to start with and make clear a basic understanding of what you mean by inerrancy. Beinert in the Handbook of Catholic Theology says, inerrancy, you should understand the freedom from error in Scripture. Very simple. And then from an evangelical point of view, this definition, inerrancy at its most basic is merely the confession that the Bible is without factual error in those things that it affirms. Of course, much more can be said and will be said in the following. You may or may not know that the discussions about inerrancy take a central place in evangelicals' doctrine of Scripture. Discussions of the topic, however, is not or should not be limited to evangelicals. As a matter of fact, Pope Emeritus now Benedict XVI stated the following in 2010 in Verbum Domini. Certainly, theological reflection has always considered inspiration and truth as two key concepts for an ecclesial hermeneutic of the sacred scriptures. Nonetheless, one must acknowledge the need today for a fuller and more adequate study of these realities in order better to respond to the need to interpret the sacred texts in accordance with their nature. Here, I would express my fervent hope that research in this field will progress and bear fruit both for biblical science and for the spiritual life of the faithful. The former Pope thus expresses the need for more theological reflection on issues concerning the truth of Scripture. I hardly applaud this invitation. As we will see, such discussion is both unavoidable and necessary within evangelicalism. The one could question that the issue is really that important for a Roman Catholic theology of Scripture. Whereas the last decades have seen a flow of publications on inerrancy from intra-evangelical perspectives, there's been rather a dearth on the Roman Catholic side. It looks as if the topic came to a standstill with Vatican II. Before and up to the Council, the issue was regularly discussed, but the number of publications in the last decade that deal directly with the topic are very limited indeed. However, one recent Roman Catholic interpreter calls biblical inerrancy nevertheless one of the watershed issues of our time. This quote is a little surprising for me, if the issue has not been discussed widely in the last decades. Perhaps this conservative Catholic voice from North America shows rather that issues pertaining to inerrancy are a North American problem. For amongst evangelicals, it is especially in the United States that inerrancy is a hot topic, much less so elsewhere. But even if we somehow could delimit the problem of inerrancy geographically to the United States or America, we live in such times that when buttons are pushed in the States, the consequences are felt throughout the world. In any case, we have the invitation from the Pope Benedictus to study the issue more thoroughly. I hope that it will become clear that touching upon the issue of the inerrancy of Scriptures, we are dealing with the importance of Scriptures for the inner life of faith and for church and tradition, one of the four central topics of Lest. It is my conviction that in further research on the truth of Scripture, Catholics can learn from evangelical perspectives and evangelicals can learn from Catholic perspectives. In that sense, my lecture hopes to offer a small contribution to an ecumenically oriented reflection on the renewal and reform of the Church. It remains to be seen if we can steer the topic beyond polemics. Then, third, I will continue with sketching some dogmatic theological observations of similarities and differences in the respective theologies of Scripture, theology of Scripture, inspiration, and inerrancy. And then finally, fourthly, I will conclude with a couple of suggestions for a way forward. A brief, very short introduction to what is evangelicalism, for those of you who are not familiar with it. Basically, evangelicalism, how I want to define it, it is a reform and reactionary movement. I find it necessary to at least to try to define what I understand evangelicalism to be, although it is a notoriously difficult task, yet important. In the mainly Euro-Catholic setting of this conference, the word evangelical is certainly not uniform. And I do not want to use the use of the word to be tainted by unnecessary connotations or outright wrong understandings. It's the case that due to many misunderstandings, a lot of evangelicals, both in the States and worldwide, are questioning if they should continue to self-identify as evangelicals. Although, perhaps in the near future, another term will come up, for the purpose of this lecture, I will continue to use the term and try to define it as good as possible. I say evangelicalism is a reform and reactionary movement. The contemporary Protestant evangelical tradition is a movement that is rooted in three or four layers of Protestantism. The oldest layer is, of course, that of the Reformation itself, of the 16th century. If Protestantism can be summarily described by the five solas, evangelicalism can be considered as firmly rooted in Protestantism. Evangelicalism as an heir to Protestantism is a reaction against corruption in the late medieval Catholic Church. A second constitutive movement for evangelicalism is Pietism of the 17th century. Evangelicalism, as heir of Pietism, is a reaction against the dead orthodoxy of the Protestant Church in the 17th century. The third and most direct basis of the evangelical movement can be traced to Britain and the United States, beginning in the period 1735 to 1765. That period was marked by a series of revivals, that is, intense periods of extraordinary response to gospel proclamation, complemented by an unusual dedication to pious living. Evangelicalism as heir of revivalism is a reaction against the dry and sterile formalism of the mainline Protestant churches. And then fourth, the most recent layer in the history of evangelicalism can be traced to the latter decades of the 19th century, in the beginning of the 20th. The new challenge for Protestant Christianity appeared in the form of biblical higher criticism and findings of modern science that seemed to undermine the teaching of historic Christianity. Evangelicalism as heir of this movement is a reaction against liberal Protestantism, by re-emphasizing and defending the traditional Orthodox Protestant Christian teachings based on the secure, indubitable foundation that is Scripture. For our purposes, it is important to understand that evangelicalism is a reactionary movement across denominations, combining Orthodox Protestant and historic Christian doctrinal allegiance with personal piety and missionary zeal. And in that movement, the Bible obtains the preeminent role, both in doctrine and in spirituality. Now, as to the history of inerrancy in Catholic and evangelical sources, if we look prior to Vatican II in the Roman Catholic Church, we see that what I think is probably the first formal ecclesial affirmation of inerrancy comes in Vatican II, 1870, in De Fide Catholica, where it is said that Scripture contains revelation without error. And then in 1893, the encyclical by Pope Leo XIII, Providentissimus Deus, on the study of Holy Scripture, which is a reaction to, amongst others, the book by Loisy. There it's stated, amongst other things, it is absolutely wrong and forbidden either to narrow inspiration to certain parts only of Holy Scripture or to admit that the sacred writer has erred. Also, the limitation of inspiration to the matters of faith and morals is not allowed. Then in 1920, Benedict XV wrote his encyclical Spiritus Paracletus, where he repeats much of Leo's encyclical, especially concerning the inerrancy of Scripture. This work had also the effect of making historical critical research of the Bible for Roman Catholics a very difficult task. That situation changed in 1943, when Pius XII wrote Divino Afflandi Spiritu. He opens up the field of biblical studies to the historical critical method. But as regards the doctrine of Scripture, the encyclical reaffirms the traditional doctrines of inspiration and inerrancy of the Bible, although in a different key. So we are coming towards the eve of Vatican II, and we see that before Vatican II, and actually also during the Council, a lot of theological activity was taking place concerning the doctrine of Scripture, concerning its inspiration and concerning inerrancy. Several authors were very active, amongst them also some of the Leuven faculty here, but also people like Lofink, like Rahmer, like Platzinger, like Winman, like Schöckel. So when we go back to the evangelical scene for a short period, we see, interestingly enough, a similar development. In the early 1880s, the Presbyterian minister Charles Briggs said that Scripture is inspired yet errant. And that started a whole debate about the inerrancy of Scripture, which led in almost 10 years later, 1893, to his being defrocked from the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church. At the same time, the old Princeton theologians Benjamin Warfield and Charles Hodge wrote the article called Inspiration. They developed their view of the inerrancy of Scripture in the context of opposition to developing liberal theology of the 19th century. The great legacy of Benjamin Warfield was the elevation of plenary verbal inspiration resulting in inerrancy. And it is the elevation to the primary position in the doctrine of Scriptures. And that is probably something new in the history of theology, to place that part of the doctrine of Scripture to the primary place. That's a new development that is actually specific to the situation in the United States, and that has since then marked evangelicalism in the United States very sharply. In the beginning of the 20th century, between 1910 and 1915, 12 paperback volumes were written called The Fundamentals, from where our word fundamentalism comes. These were written by a whole host of scholars countering liberal Protestantism with affirmation of classic Christian and Protestant dogma, amongst them inerrancy of scripture. And then another important point was in 1949, the establishment of the Evangelical Theological Society in the United States. The decision was made to form a society composed of independent individuals of conservative evangelical conviction with one common denominator, scholarship based on the concept of biblical inerrancy. The Evangelical Theological Society in the States still has a doctrinal basis of 2 points. At the beginning, there was only 1 point. You had to affirm the inerrancy of Scripture. And every member must subscribe in writing annually to the doctrinal basis. That is still the case today. In the 1990s, a second element was entered next to the inerrancy of Scripture, was the accepting the Trinity. Most of you are very familiar with what happened at Vatican II and since then, concerning the doctrine of Scripture. There are 3 magisterial documents of paramount importance. Of course, the Verbum, and then after Vatican, you have the document on the interpretation of the Bible and the Church, and the post-synodal apostolic exhortation, Verbum Domini. The most important is undoubtedly the Verbum. And on the issue of inerrancy, it is the Verbum number 11 that is most important. But one must understand that the Verbum has an important prehistory, both in the development of the preparatory schema De Fontibus, as well as the different drafts that were made during the Council. Inerrancy figured largely in these discussions, even though it is only in the Verbum 11 that the topic of inerrancy is mentioned. And I read from the Verbum 11. Therefore, since everything asserted by the inspired authors or sacred writers must be held to be asserted by the Holy Spirit, it follows that the books of Scripture must be acknowledged as teaching solidly, faithfully, and without error, that truth which God wanted to put in sacred writings for the sake of our salvation. Unfortunately, this sentence has received almost opposite interpretations after the Council. Some argue that the Council in effect limited inerrancy to those truths concerning our salvation. The argument that Scripture's freedom from error is now linked with truth insofar as it pertains to the saving purposes of God. Truth not directly linked with our salvation, it is said, does not enjoy the same privilege of being preserved from error. But then others vehemently claim that the Council is clearly upholding the previous magisterial pronouncements on the issue, based on a different grammatical reading of the text. And in support of this, the fact that the Verbum itself suggests as much by choosing to cite 2 modern magisterial affirmations of the absolute inerrancy of Scripture in the first footnote to the teaching on inspiration. I think it is partly because of these contradictory readings of the Verbum 11 that Benedict XVI in Verbum Domini urged for further theological research on the topic. We are about to finish our historical sketch by going back to evangelicalism since after Vatican II. That period is characterized by what you could call the battle for the Bible, and perhaps also inerrancy, a paradigm in crisis. In the United States, inerrancy for evangelicals is very serious business. Several evangelical scholars lost their job or had to move to other institutions because of discussions about inerrancy. In 1978, the Chicago Statement on Biblical Inerrancy was drafted. On the basis of this document, Robert Gundry was ousted from the Evangelical Theological Society in 1983. His commentary on the Gospel of Matthew was considered to be in conflict with inerrancy, although he himself continued to subscribe to the doctrinal basis of inerrancy. Since the 90s, the discussions within the Evangelical Theological Society in the States have never abated, but often produce more heat than light. Several other evangelical scholars, as I said already, lost their jobs on this issue. Now, Stephen Holmes from the United Kingdom observes, "I see that the language of inerrancy is almost wholly absent from the confessional documents of British evangelicalism over the same period. It seems to me surprising that so central a claim on one side of the Atlantic should be virtually unknown, or if known, unaccepted on the other." I think it's important to keep that in mind. that inerrancy is a paradigm in crisis has many reasons, but I cannot go into detail there. I can briefly mention that one reason is evangelicalism's problematic relation with historical criticism. A second reason is that inerrancy is being reconsidered on the basis of the texts of violence in scripture. And the third reason is because of the problem of defining inerrancy. The Chicago Statement on Biblical Inerrancy is a document of about 10 pages trying to explain what inerrancy is and what it is not. If you need so many pages to describe or define a term, perhaps there are too many qualifications needed. But a more foundational problem with the doctrine of inerrancy is that truth is largely viewed in propositional terms, and the theological method is conceived of in scientific terms. So we move on to my next section, a dogmatic discussion of the meaning of inerrancy. Why do we have a doctrine of inerrancy? What is the grammar of that doctrine? What is it protecting? Denis Farkasvaldi says that, and I quote, "If God is the author of the Bible, it must not contain anything unworthy of him." This type of statement is probably the oldest formulation of the principle of inerrancy and can be found with frequency in the writings of the anti-Gnostic Church fathers of the 2nd and 3rd centuries, unquote. Is not, and these are my words, is not the concept of inerrancy basically to be stated positively? Inerrancy means that scripture teaches the truth. It does not mislead us. Well, perhaps here is the appropriate place to point out an embarrassment with respect to the discussion about inerrancy. I believe an open discussion is difficult in academic settings because we're also dealing with issues of faith, of what we believe. I think that such a discussion must be held at the interface of academia and ecclesia. And I wonder whether the lack of theological discussion is sometimes not linked to this issue. Or is it, and I'm being a bit cynical now, because we cannot find funding from our secular authorities for these issues, that it remains to be developed? I think there are a number of unsolved theological issues that pertain to the meaning of the doctrine of inerrancy, which I will briefly point out. First is the relation of scripture and revelation. Second, the issue of authority. Third, sola scriptura and its relation to tradition. Fourth, the usefulness of the incarnational analogy. And then fifth, something on the propositional content of revelation. So starting with the first one, the relation of scripture and revelation, and what I perceive to be a conflating of revelation and scripture, especially in evangelical writings. I think one reason why inerrancy is more of an urgent issue in evangelical circles as compared to Roman Catholicism is that in Catholic theology, Scripture is usually not exclusively equated with revelation. As Ratzinger observed, the fact that tradition exists is primarily based on the non-identity of the two realities, revelation and Scripture. Scripture is never the only way in which God is mediated. It is only one among several ways, sacraments. Could it be that Roman Catholic communities are less textual communities and more sacramental communities, and that they therefore suffer less from the problem of inerrancy? Protestant theologian Martin Lesser argues, when all forms of God's mediation are refused, all except one, Scripture, then all weight will be laid on this one form of mediation. When that is the case, the danger of idolatry becomes real. Too often, one notes in evangelicalism a facile equation of revelation and Scripture. This unfortunate confounding results in a wrong-headed focus. It is a sorry state, since this confounding is not reflected in the earliest sources of evangelicalism. And moreover, it has been pointed out before by leading evangelical scholars. I think that the evangelical movement has within itself the resources to develop a theology of revelation and a bibliology that is different and healthier. As the situation stands, one could get the impression that evangelical bibliology is in danger of usurping the place of Christology. With equation of the Bible and the Word of God, it is common to understand the Bible as necessary for salvation. Perhaps it is not only the place of Christology that has been taken over by evangelical bibliology. The same danger may well exist where pneumatology is concerned. There is a tendency to understand the Spirit as a function of the Bible, rather than the role of the Bible being made clear in view of pneumatology. It is quite common for handbooks of evangelical systematic theology to start with bibliology before the doctrine of God is broached. Suggestions to discuss bibliology under the heading of pneumatology have only recently been appropriated. However, also, magisterial texts of the Roman Catholic Church sometimes make confused remarks about the differentiation between Scripture and Revelation. Raymond Bieringer has pointed this out in a discussion of the Verbum, of the interpretation of the Bible in the Church, and of Verbum Domini. He pleads for a more developed theology of Revelation. It has become clear, he argues, that neither the Verbum nor the two official documents pertaining to its reception reflect explicitly on the relation between Revelation and Scriptures. A second theological issue is what I call the issue of authority, or in McIntyrean terms, whose Bible, which council. Christian Smith wrote the book The Bible Made Impossible, why Biblicism is not a truly evangelical reading of Scripture. He convincingly demonstrates the pervasive interpretive pluralism that exists among evangelicals who all claim to hold to the inerrancy of Scripture. If the Bible is our final authority, then one can be sure that the Bible will be molded into our image and likeness. It is then no coincidence that you find in evangelicalism very diverse and sometimes contradictory answers based on the Bible. One would think that in Roman Catholicism, the existence of a teaching authority would settle the issue of authority. However, as a Protestant in a Catholic theology department, I must say that I have often thought, with not a little bewilderment, why don't they stick to their texts? Of course, this is a typical Protestant way of approaching Catholic authority. But it remains a fact that issues are not as easily settled in Catholicism as one would sometimes hope, or perhaps some would hope not. It is then no coincidence that you find very diverse and sometimes contradictory answers to theological questions in Catholic publications, all based on the same documents of Vatican II. It is well known that the reception of Vatican II is a moot issue, and the positions taken by Catholic theologians differ significantly depending on whether they adopt the hermeneutics of continuity or of discontinuity. A joke. Amongst evangelicals, if a question is asked and you don't know the answer, you have basically two options. You can say Jesus, or you can say the Bible. For Catholics, especially at this faculty here, if you don't know the answer, you always play safe by answering Vatican II. I think it is for those Catholic theologians who allow for human errors in scripture, it is easier for them to allow for a hermeneutics of discontinuity regarding tradition, and Vatican II in particular. If God can speak through the human errors in scripture, then perhaps it is not too difficult for God to overcome human frailty in tradition. Errancy in scripture does not nullify its trustworthiness and its inspiration. In the same way, tradition's discontinuities do not nullify its trustworthiness, nor the affirmation of the guidance of the Spirit. Third, theological issue, sola scriptura and the relation of scripture and tradition. Verbum Dominum in number 17 and 18 asks for more study on refining or understanding of scripture, tradition, and the magisterium, and how they interrelate, and on the material sufficiency of scripture. It is now common to find nuanced discussions amongst evangelicals on the meaning of sola scriptura. Quite often one can find arguments to distinguish sola scriptura from solo scriptura, or from nuda scriptura, the naked scriptures. Some now prefer to speak of prima scriptura to make clear the ancillary role of tradition. Henk van den Belt has argued that the solas, as watchwords or central doctrines of the Reformation, were formulated in reaction against the ultramontanist Roman Catholicism that declared the Pope infallible at Vatican I. He goes so far as to claim that Vatican II's view of the relation between scripture and tradition comes close to the way the relationship between scripture and tradition functioned for many 16th century Protestants. There's some area for research here, I believe. Fourth theological theme, scripture and the incarnational analogy. An explanation what I mean by incarnational analogy, and I will do that by quoting the Verbum 13. It is also used in Divino Afflante Spiritu number 37, but I quote the Verbum 13. Indeed, the words of God expressed in the words of man are in every way like human language, just as the word of the Eternal Father, when he took on himself the flesh of human weakness, became like man. There seems to be a convergence of some sorts between Catholic and evangelical approaches. Evangelical biblical scholar Peter Enns wrote a book called Inspiration and Incarnation, which tries on the incarnational analogy, and he defends it in his second edition against attacks that have been raised against it. The incarnational analogy is proposed by both Catholics and evangelicals, yet it is also debated and contested by scholars from both traditions. Interestingly enough, the incarnational analogy can lead both to a confirmation and a denial of absolute inerrancy. Yet I want to mention several cautions that authors have leveled against using the incarnational analogy. Torrance, when reviewing Warfield's bibliology, he said that Warfield's position on scripture to be correct, there would have to have been an incarnation of the Holy Spirit, with the Bible being the incarnation of the Holy Spirit. That's the danger that can happen if you take the incarnational analogy too far. Others say, yes, it may be helpful, but it has the danger of elevating scripture to divine status, to hypothesizing human words. Michael Bird says that if you use this analogy, you're in danger of having a Quranic view of the Bible. Several authors therefore caution us to look more closely into the applicability of the incarnational model. A question I have with regards to this model: why is the analogy of the incarnation always applied to errors in scripture and not to sin? The incarnational analogy of scripture does not necessarily imply a text free from errors. Jesus Christ, at the same time fully human and fully divine, is free from sin, but not necessarily from errors. The human person Jesus stumbled and fell. He made mistakes in grammar and spelling, I assume, yet these and other errors did not prevent him to accomplish his mission without fault, to save humankind. It is sin that mars the relation between God and people, not errors. Inerrancy, with its focus on errors, points in the direction of propositional truth, whereas free from sin points towards personal relational truth. Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father than through me." So truth is a relational category in Johannine terms. Perhaps if that is our focus, some of the problems disappear. Finally, I come to the conclusion and I suggest three possible ways forward who are not who can be complementary. Not excluding one another. I think that the future of the theology of inerrancy is ecumenical, is pneumatological, and is sacramental. First, the way forward is first of all ecumenical. I think for the sake of the Church and the world, Roman Catholic theologians should not leave the terrain of inerrancy to evangelicals alone. My call may not be as authoritative as that of Benedict XVI in Verbum Domini, but nevertheless I issue a similar invitation to further study and theologically develop the thinking on inspiration and the truth of scripture and their interrelatedness. Leeuwenhoeven has stressed the dialogical character of revelation as found in the Verbum and at Vatican II as a whole. Perhaps on the human side, the dialogue partners can also include the separated brothers and sisters. I share the opinion of Daniel Fryer. I quote, "Whereas a dogmatic account of scripture should focus on authoritative church consensus regarding God's action, polemics arise because the church no longer hears the word as one body. The church Catholic is needed for the people of God to grow in understanding." Or as Willy Magda Kaiden says, "Ecclesiastical consensus also has to be acknowledged as a common way for doctrine to develop." The second way forward is pneumatological. A doctrine of scripture should be thoroughly set in pneumatological categories. As I said, recent evangelical systematic theologies increasingly take this into account. Here, I think an opportunity presents itself to recognize the ecumenical resource of the contributions of Pentecostal theologians. I mentioned James Smith and Amos Young as leading scholars whose contributions in this area should not be neglected. And then finally, I think the way forward is sacramental. Another ecumenical convergence between Catholics and evangelicals that is taking place concerns the view that the theologians should look at the sacramentality of scripture. I simply mentioned the Verbum, Norbert Lofink, or Gerald Collins. Many could be added. These from the Catholic side who made this observation. Among the evangelicals, I mentioned Roger Olson, Daniel Trier, and Hans Bursman. Evangelicalism has a high view of scripture. Scripture is closely associated with the Word of God. I believe that this creates space to understand scripture as a means to participate in the life of God. Hence, an opening is made to consider scripture as sacramental. Evangelicalism has always had an openness towards the unity of scripture and towards the sensus plenior. I am aware that talking about the sensus plenior is opening a can of worms. However, if we open the can and take the worm, perhaps we can catch a big fish. This year, Hans Boersma published his book, Scripture as Real Presence, Sacramental Exegesis in the Early Church. The book and its approach, I believe, show an ecumenical forward. And what about inerrancy? Is it forgotten? Or perhaps a sacramental look can have a different perspective. I'm just thinking out loud now. The water must not be 100% clean to be able to baptize. The bread and wine don't need to be perfect to communicate. To communicate Christ. And the priest should not necessarily be without sin in order to speak the absolution. So perhaps a sacramental understanding of scripture can help us shift our focus from errors, real or alleged, in scripture to meeting Christ in scripture, so that we become transformed into his likeness by the power of the Spirit to the glory of God.